Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. This is the 48th annual conference of Endocrine Society of India, ESICON 2018, and we are live with Dr. Beena Bansal here on ESI TV. Well, she is the director at Division of Endocrinology, Medanta, Gurgaon. Welcome, ma'am, on board with us. So, ESICON 2018 is right here with a widespread of scientific programs spread across 4 days with many more interactive initiatives that have been incorporated for this year's symposium. I would want to understand, you are about to present a session today. So as far as today's symposium is concerned, the topic says premature ovarian insufficiency. So could you please tell our audience as to what overview do you have to share and what do we look forward to?
So, as the name suggests, once the ovaries, the function of ovaries are reduced prematurely, usually the ovarian function is reduced at the age of around 50 years. But if that happens before 40 years of age, it is called premature ovarian failure or premature ovarian insufficiency. The word failure is kind of avoided nowadays. We don't want to use that term failure. Yeah. Because of the negative connotation it has on a woman and on her individuality and on her femininity. Also because it's not a complete failure always, there is some bit of function left, so they can have intermittent function for some time. So any woman who has reduced ovarian function before the age of 40 would be labeled as having premature ovarian insufficiency. It is a devastating disorder, to put it simply, and patients would go to 2-3 doctors, gynecologists for their fertility management, and they are already kind of aware of their disease and they have gone through that processing of the diagnosis. But if you are the one to break the diagnosis to them, it's not easy. So the most important thing with this is to deal with the woman very sensitively. So their issues usually with premature ovarian insufficiency, a girl would come with her parents and they would be worried about her marriage, or the woman would come and she would be planning fertility and her major concern is whether she would be pregnant or not. So once we get over those issues, which are difficult because fertility is seen in only 5-10% females after they are diagnosed with POI or premature ovarian insufficiency, it's also important to explain to them about the long-term problems with POI, because if we lose that opportunity, they may not come back to you because their only thing was to have become pregnant. So it's important in the first visit and the subsequent visit to also tell them that medically, for your health, it's important to get this treated, because women with POI have increased risk for heart disease in future, increased risk for fractures, because estrogen protects the heart, it protects the bones, and they are deficient in estrogens at least 10 or more years before it should that should happen. It also impairs their mood and leads to depression, not just the diagnosis, shattered dreams, but also estrogen deficiency per se leads to depression, and it also leads to sexual problems. So all these issues also they have to be dealt with, and we explain to them the importance of hormone replacement therapy. There is again a negative connotation with that word, hormone replacement, because of the popular notion about hormones in menopausal females leading to increased breast cancer and increased heart disease. That's the only thing people remember, and they forget that the benefits definitely outweigh the risks in premature ovarian insufficiency. So estrogen therapy is required in almost all patients with POI, unless it's really contraindicated, for example, if they have breast cancer, at least till the age of 50 years. So that would be my basic message, that estrogen not only would reduce the risk of heart disease, fractures, also increases longevity. So estrogen therapy has been shown to reduce mortality, and that has to be emphasized, that it's their health. And So it's like approaching the women from all different angles, dealing very sensitively and taking all these aspects.
I think you've rightly mentioned dealing sensitively becomes really very crucial, and the severity of the problem is what we need to understand, because POI and fertility management, the kind of social issues women come up with, what is the right approach as when we want to bring about diagnosis options to them? So many difficulties that come along, challenges. So this is something that we would want. Yes. What is the right address for this?
Okay. So, in our society, definitely, it's sad that the family members, not just the in-laws, but the own patient's family members, the major concern is whether she'll get pregnant and there will be a baby or not. So, so when you are actually talking to the family, it's very, very tricky. You have to kind of give accurate information that the risk of spontaneous pregnancy is very low, and egg transfer or embryo transfers are the best options available, and these are quite successful options available nowadays. So those options are there. Of course, also to discuss with the woman that it's her life and the decision rests on her. So when I give them the options, I start from number one, wait and see. Maybe you conceive spontaneously, although the chances are low. Number two, maybe you don't need a child. Think about other things in your relationship, in your life. It's not an easy conversation if I do that. Adoption, that's a valid option. And then I come to oocyte and embryo transfer, which are very successful therapies, also quite expensive and not always successful, but these are good therapies to offer. So we have lots of these options. Also, a lot of POI cases are because of treatment for some other disease. For example, malignancy treatments with chemotherapy and radiation. So before even POI happens, there is an opportunity to preserve fertility. It's not still very ongoing. We usually have that opportunity missed. So cryopreservation, we call it, is something which probably needs to be discussed more often before the woman undergoes chemotherapy or radiation or some other illness.
That's about it, I guess. Yes. Thank you so much, ma'am, for joining in with us and on ESI TV. This is indeed an absolutely interesting conversation that we've just had. Thank you once again for joining in with us.